Subscribe to our YouTube channel and press the bell icon to get the latest updates.
I'm with Jairam Ramesh, Senior Congress Leader and Head of the Parliamentary Committee on Science and Technology, the Environment, Forests and Climate Change. Jairam, welcome to ThePrint.
Hi.
This has been an eventful week, to say the least. We've had the Ayodhya verdict. We've had the crisis in Maharashtra, where finally the Congress party seems to be in the play, at least, in the formation of a government in India's largest and perhaps richest state. And we have the state of the economy.
And we had the money bill verdict in the Supreme Court.
And we had the money bill verdict, and the Supreme Court has had a say on that, and we'll talk about this. But the economy, where the indicators are very distressing, to say the least. Industrial production is down once again.
Yeah.
You have been a key critic, not only of the Modi government, but have also been had a lot to say on this subject. Your take?
Well, I think things have gone actually from bad to worse. And we are seeing the prolonged effects of demonetization and a hastily implemented GST. Investment. There are only three engines. There's the investment engine that is sputtering, the consumption engine that is sputtering, and the export engine that just stopped, right? So none of the growth drivers are really moving ahead. But what you hear from the government is that everything is fine, everything is okay. But the fact is, everything is not okay. There is a crisis of confidence in the economy. The international forget the international economy for the time being. We're looking at the domestic economy. Small, medium businesses have been completely destroyed by demonetization and the effects of a hastily implemented GST.
So it is demonetization.
There is
which is 3 years old.
I have no question in my mind that the fundamentals of the economy were wrecked by demonetization, number one, and number two, by a GST, which was hastily implemented. It was badly designed to begin with, but it was equally...
But the Congress party was also on board.
We were not on board.
No, but it was your government, in the UPA government, which began the whole process.
Which was opposed by Mr. Modi at that time. Mm-hmm. Mr. Modi consistently opposed GST from 2011 to 2014.
Right.
And thereafter, when he became Prime Minister, he emerged as its greatest champion.
So then you can't say that since it was a Congress party or the UPA...
The GST, I'm not saying that the GST was a... Demonetization is a bad idea, was a terrible idea. GST is a good idea, implemented terribly. Implemented in haste. And you see the number of amendments that they've had to make in the last 2 years is reflective of the haste with which they implemented GST.
So two questions.
Particularly on small and medium businesses, which, you know, drive the Indian economy in many parts of the country.
So what are people saying when you meet industrialists, when you meet business people?
First,
what do they say?
Their mouths are shut. They're worried. There is fear. This is the other thing. Tax terrorism. Which Mr. Jaitley used to talk about. Tax terrorism, people are fearing, the people are intimidated.
They don't pay their taxes, surely people have to be investigated.
There's a CEO of Vodafone who gives a statement, you know, about the health of his company, and then, you know, he is threatened, and then he gives a counter statement the next day saying, I never said what I said. So, you know, there are people who...
But can I just say here, if people don't pay their taxes, must be investigated.
Inquiries. This is not people who are not paying this. This is people who are legitimately paying their taxes. See, what the Finance Act did in 2016 and 2017 gave extraordinarily sweeping powers to tax officials. And we objected on the floor of the House, but unfortunately, you know, we didn't have the numbers. It went through. And we are now facing the consequences. Targets are given for tax collection. And tax officials love nothing but targets, because then they can go out and hammer the taxpayers. Legitimate taxpayers are being harassed. The statements that Mohandas Pai, Kiran Mazumdar Shaw, no friends of the Congress. You know, they are independent observers. If anything, Mohandas Pai is more sympathetic towards the current ruling establishment. And both of them have spoken about how tax terrorism has wreaking havoc in business confidence.
Why do you think that the tax authorities are going after legitimate payers?
Targets have to be met. But tax collections are falling, revenue growth is not taking place. All the projections that were made that we will reach 1 lakh crores a month as far as GST collections are concerned, those are not moving. Rural demand, we have just seen yesterday, In fact, the lowest growth in rural demand in 48
years. And the government says the data
is wrong. So they jumped this consumer expenditure survey.
This is the NSO survey.
Yeah, so if the data does not fit into what the El Supremo is propagating.
Who is El Supremo?
Well, there's only one man. This is a one
but
man.
Listen, you're the Congress
it's a one
party.
Man show,
you're
two man army, you know.
But you are the Congress party, you're the chief opposition in parliament, and yet your voice doesn't seem to carry. Why don't you say these things in parliament loud enough and strongly? I think
the voice has carried in the Haryana verdict. It has certainly carried in the Maharashtra verdict, where Mr. Modi and Mr. Shah had nothing but 370 and hyper nationalism, pseudo hyper nationalism actually, not real nationalism, as their agenda. And people have voted. People have voted for economic on economic
you
grounds
think,
on
you
economic
think
issues.
You think that's what's happened in Maharashtra and Haryana, that people have voted for economic issues rather than for hyper-nationalism?
Yes, absolutely. We may not have got the majority, but certainly the BJP's propaganda, the hyper-pseudo-nationalist propaganda, has completely been debunked.
The BJP still has over 100 seats in Maharashtra.
No doubt about it. But what
did they? The verdict is not in their favor.
Verdict is certainly they've lost. Morally, they've lost politically. What were they saying? They were saying 220 plus. What was their campaign? The nationalist campaign. Mm-hmm. And they've got a beating. They've got a beating in Haryana. They've got a beating in Maharashtra. See, I think the economic distress is real. Farm distress is real. The distress for small and medium enterprises and exporters, labor intensive, garments, leather, sports goods, automotive components, these are all in distress. Now, the thing to do is to confront this distress and create an environment in which we move forward. But if at every step you want to reject the reality of economic misfortune and economic distress and try to divert people's attentions, Balakot one day, then you know, Article 370, Article 35A or something else the other day, I think this is sheer escapism from reality.
So what's the moral of the story in Maharashtra? What happened there? You think that the people didn't buy into the hyper-nationalism story?
Absolutely not. And I think Mr. Sharad Pawar was right. You know, how long can these guys keep saying 370? People are looking, farmers are looking at farmers' issues, tribals are looking at tribal issues. These were local elections. These were local elections, meaning local for the elections of the state assembly.
So, but Mr. Modi won the country 6 months ago convincingly,
remarkable. He got a convincing mandate in May 2014,
right.
And within 2019, within 4 or 5 months, that entire mandate has been squandered. I mean, look at the state of the economy today and what the economy was, say, even in May 2019.
And yet the Congress party is willing to sit with a Shiv Sena. It's an implacable foe at one, an implacable ideological foe, shall I say, once upon
there
a time.
Is,
what does that mean?
There is an ancient Cautilian maxim, the enemy of my enemy is my friend.
So now you're spouting Kautilya, which is Modi's favorite.
I'm just saying, Modi's
ideology.
He's India's favorite, India's Machiavelli. No, I think, look, in what has happened in Maharashtra is that the elected representatives of the Congress party want to have an alliance with the Shiv Sena and the NCP to keep the BJP out of power. The BJP, even though it was not the single largest party in Goa, manipulated to come into government.
Right, but you didn't say anything then.
They were, of course, we said we protested.
Okay,
on the floor of the house, outside
but
the
you
house.
You didn't reach out to your enemies.
We
enemy
went.
Like
we went
in
to in Manipur. The same thing happened. In Meghalaya, the same thing happened.
But
so,
what did you see? What are you doing in Maharashtra that's different from Goa and Manipur and Meghalaya?
No, Maharashtra is indeed a very significant realignment of forces that is taking place. You know, even though there is a certain history of the Shiv Sena, after all, you know,
but you're not
Bal
looking
Thakre,
with that, surely.
Bal Thackeray was a great admirer of Indira Gandhi. He supported Pratibha Patil and Pranab Mukherjee. You know, he broke ranks with the NDA and supported the Congress candidate for the president.
Let me finish what I'm saying.
Sure. So I'm saying that in spite of these occasions in which the Shiv Sena leadership has been positive towards the Congress. The fact is that the Congress and the Shiv Sena have been political opponents, no doubt about it. And therefore, the realignment that is taking place with the NCP, we are an alliance partner.
Absolutely. I mean,
NCP came out of the Congress, so there's no problem there. But with the Shiv Sena, it is indeed a paradigm shift,
and there's no running away from that fact.
That it reflects a fundamental paradigm shift in Maharashtra's politics, and it shows that allies are most uncomfortable with the BJP. But one immediate consequence of what happened in Maharashtra is that the allies in Jharkhand have deserted the BJP.
That's right.
So, you know,
you're talking about the Lok Jan Shakti Party of Ramdas Paswan.
And the answer. And by the way, these are not the first man to realize that the BJP will gobble him up if he's in alliance with them was Naveen Patnaik. Mm-hmm. Naveen Patnaik became a legend the day he walked out of the BJP and set up, you know, sort of put the BJD as an independent force in state politics. So, the BJP will not allow any other party to grow when it is in an alliance.
But I just want to come back
that's
to
that's very clear. And that's what has happened in Shiv Sena. Obviously, promises made to the Shiv Sena before the elections have not been kept.
But you're saying yourself that the Shiv Sena was an ideological foe at one point of time, but today you're willing to sup with the devil, if you like.
We are trying
to... devil, may I add right
here. No, I think what's happening in the last couple of days is that the Congress, the NCP and the Shiv Sena are finding a common platform, a common agenda. There are many things common. And I think what is being worked out is a platform which brings the commonalities of this. Of course, we cannot run away from the fact that right now the enemy for each of the three is the BJP. And there is a determination on the part of the local Congress party and its supporters that we must keep the BJP out of power, because they've done damage in Maharashtra for the last 5 years, and this Maharashtra cannot sustain another 5 years of BJP rule.
But so for the Shiv Sena as well, the foremost enemy is the BJP,
no,
and therefore they're willing to
look.
The
BJP and the Shiv Sena were pre-poll allies.
Right.
Okay. The NCP and the Congress were pre-poll allies. But now we are getting one pre-poll formation being broken. That is a significant change, as I said, a significant realignment of political forces.
So what does this do to Prime Minister Narendra Modi and to the BJP?
No, what it shows, I hope this allies have always been uncomfortable with the BJP. Nitish Kumar has been very uncomfortable with the BJP.
What happens to Nitish?
Paswan has been uncomfortable. I hope all these guys, you know, the Shiromani Akali Dal has been, you know, very uncomfortable with the BJP. So I hope that the NDA allies now realize that their future, they are not going to grow in alliance with the BJP.
So would you say that there is a separate message that the country gives Prime Minister Modi
when
national elections are taking place and a separate one in the states?
This is a bigger message for Mr. Modi and Mr. Amit Shah, that the politics of threats, the politics of intimidation, the politics of saying one thing and doing another thing, this will not sustain for too long.
And how do you tie this up with the economy? We started this discussion by saying that the economy is in dire straits.
No, it is. I mean, I can't see any bright spots, actually. And the verdict in Haryana, Panipat, you look at the way the textile industry, for example, or the auto component industry in Haryana has been adversely affected over the last year or two. You look at the way the farmers have come out and protested, the tribals have come out and protested in Maharashtra. So there is a message here for the government in power, that whatever you may be claiming, $5 trillion economy and so on by the year 2025, the hard reality on the ground is that, you know, it is a story of economic distress. And it's a story of economic stagnation. I mean, we are now going to get, this quarter, July, August, September 2019, when the data will be released, you know, a couple of days from now, you will see the lowest quarterly growth in the last 8 years, in the last 20 quarters.
Well,
you will
already
see the
have the worst GDP in the last 6 years, which is
5%. You will see the lowest in the last 8 years. And I've told you, as far as consumer spending is concerned, you have seen it in the last 48 years, the lowest this year. So, I mean, look, these are these are very strong signals.
So you don't see green shoots. You don't see green shoots in the country.
Right now, I don't see any green shoots. I see loss of investor confidence. I see great uncertainty on the international economy. And in the midst of that, the Prime Minister almost, led us into the regional corporate, the RCEP.
Jairam, you were also in, only a couple of months ago in August, you also said publicly that the Congress party should not demonize Prime Minister Modi.
I'm not demonizing him. I'm just saying that these are the realities of the situation.
But you were hauled over the coals for that statement.
Look, who can oppose the insolvency and bankruptcy code? Okay, if promoters are taking money out of their companies, promoters should be changed. And that's what the insolvency and bankruptcy code does. It creates a market for promoters. Who can oppose it? Mm-hmm. But...
So is that why you said not to demonize?
Yeah, I mean, there are things. But is that going to lead to an economic recovery?
You said there are things,
immediately.
For example, also on the BSNL, MTNL
GST,
crisis.
Take GST for example.
Okay.
The fact that he did a GST U-turn on GST was a welcome U-turn that he did on GST. We had always been advocating GST from 2011 onwards.
Right.
So, I mean, there are things that the government has done.
Like what? Give me some
examples. I've given you the example on GST. Aadhaar was a program that we started. Was implemented largely during our time, but it got completely hijacked and subverted and taken away in a completely different direction.
So what was the sense in which you said that the Congress party shouldn't demonize Prime Minister Modi?
No, you have to look at what he is doing, and unfortunately, by the example of the IBC was not quoted,
right.
And I gave the example of the IBC. I said, how can oppose insolvency and bankruptcy code if public money is locked into companies that are lying closed because the promoters are not doing anything to revive them, then the government should step in, and that's what the code does.
So what you're saying is that the chief opposition party like yours should not just blindly oppose the Prime Minister but look at issues.
Mr. Pranab Mukherjee once, one of the immortal statements of Mr. Pranab Mukherjee to me and to many of my colleagues in the Congress party was that the job of the opposition party is to oppose, expose and depose.
Okay.
I mean, this was, 25 years ago.
But you're not following Pranab Mukherjee's advice.
I remember, I don't know whether he'll stick to that advice, but I remember him very clearly telling us, oppose, expose and depose. Okay. That is the job of the opposition party. I mean,
Pranab Mukherjee, in a sense, has always, he went to the RSS headquarters
in a parliamentary.
You have abandoned a lot of your own leaders, Pranab Mukherjee, for example.
Well, he's now no longer in politics.
Yes, of course.
The day he became president,
exactly.
He ceased to be a congressman, so he became a public figure.
His advice to you to expose and to depose, you didn't follow personally because you also justified a lot of.
No, we are opposing him. I've opposed him in Parliament on many things.
Right.
I've supported some of the legislation that he has brought forward. See, opposition does not mean that you just close your eyes and say, okay, this is coming from their side, I'm going to oppose. I mean, the National Medical Commission Bill. Let's take another example.
Yeah.
There was a notoriously corrupt body, the Medical Council of India. After 2 years of discussion, standing committee, debate, here and there, the government came forward with a bill to abolish the MCI and substitute it by the National Commission. Mm. I welcomed it on the floor of the House. The bill passed. Does that mean we should oppose this? Mm. See, you can't do a blind non-cooperation movement.
Sure.
This is a democratically elected government. Mm. Sometimes they come with legislation which we have enacted, which is, say, amended or which is improved. I think these are examples.
Aadhaar, for example. You completely abandoned Aadhaar.
Which one?
Aadhaar.
No, we didn't abandon it. I went to the Supreme Court on Aadhaar saying that Aadhaar is being passed in government as a money bill issue. My challenge was not the challenge of the civil society organization. The civil society organization were challenging it on the grounds of privacy violation.
Yeah.
I was challenging it on the narrow grounds that it was passed as a money bill, denying the Rajya Sabha its constitutional right for debate and passing amendments, which incidentally was upheld in Chandrajud's minority dissenting judgment.
Yeah.
So, these are things... We didn't oppose the concept of Aadhaar. And let me also say, Aadhaar was meant to ensure better delivery of subsidies and financial benefits
right.
to the weaker sections of society. I never envisaged having an Aadhaar card in my life.
Right.
I never expected you would have an Aadhaar card. But Aadhaar is being made mandatory for everything.
Hmm.
This was not the UPA conception of Aadhaar.
But just to
UPA
come back,
concept of Aadhaar was fertilizer subsidy, food subsidy, kerosene subsidies, where subsidies are being given,
hmm.
where financial benefits are being transferred to poor and vulnerable sections
of society.
So what
do you think Aadhaar has happened today? How do you think it's been transformed?
Being a true, it's violated privacy. Why should, let's take me as an example. I never imagined that Aadhaar was going to be an instrument for me.
Hmm.
Why should I need an Aadhaar card? Aadhaar was originally to remove
Aadhaar. After the poor of India welcome the Aadhaar
card.
There is a large
amount of exclusion happening in Aadhaar, in pension payments, in food subsidy payments. We have pointed this out repeatedly in Parliament.
Okay, so to come back to your advice to the Congress party that you cannot have a blanket
non-cooperation. It was a statement made in the context of legislation
right.
that the government brings forward.
Hmm.
And sometimes, giving you another example, we bought in 2013 legislation for abolition of manual scavenging.
Right.
Okay? This government comes forward with making that legislation even tougher.
Hmm.
We have to welcome it. Why should we oppose it? Just because we have not bought it.
So your colleague Shashi Tharoor as well as Abhishek Manu Singhvi also said a lot of things that were complimentary to the Prime Minister.
I think.
But why was there so much criticism within the Congress?
I don't think it's complimentary. I don't think we are saying.
No, they essentially said the same thing, which is you cannot just have a blanket ban against what the Prime Minister's party does.
When you're in a parliamentary system of government,
yeah.
the job of the executive is to execute.
Sure.
The job of the opposition is to oppose. But agreed, that's a theoretical principle. But in practice, there are occasions in which in Parliament, multiple times, there are legislations that come forward on which we can have very little disagreement about.
So why
but there will also be occasions, there will also, I mean, for example, under no circumstances can the Congress party support the Citizenship Amendment Bill.
Hmm.
I mean, that's something that we cannot support.
But just before we talk about that, your own colleague Shashi Tharoor and Abhishek Singhvi, again, the Congress party, like with you, was very, very critical of these comments that were supportive of the Prime Minister.
The criticism was magnified by you people in the media in search of a masala. I don't think...
So the Congress party was okay with your comments on the Prime Minister?
People have different views, yaar. We are not one party, one view.
Right.
You know, we have one party, we have different views. And as I said, it's the package of the views that are important. And there are occasions in which the BJP has supported us when we were in power. Does that mean that the BJP and we have come to an understanding? No. In 2013, the BJP supported our land acquisition bill wholeheartedly, unanimously. It became law. Does that mean that there was some secret understanding between the BJP and the Congress? No. You look at the merits of the case and then you decide. But the fundamental thing is that there is a fundamental flaw in Mr. Modi's style of governance. It is a style of governance that is based on threat, on intimidation, on bluff, on bluster. On that, there can be no compromise.
So there is no soft faction within the Congress party that is willing to be much more open and permeable to the
BJP. I think this is a complete myth. I think there is a complete myth to think that there is a soft Moditva. There is no soft Moditva.
No, in the Congress party.
No, absolutely not. I think
you did welcome the Ayodhya judgment, for example, which 5-0 said that
it
should be a temple in Ayodhya.
Please read the resolution. We respected the judgment. Please read what the resolution says. I'm not straying from what the working committee resolution, which is the highest policy making body in the
party.
In the party. We respect the judgment. The judgment has, has put an end to a dispute that has divided our society for decades. Now let's move on.
But it was your own former Prime Minister Narasimha Rao who said in 1993, after the demolition of the Babri Masjid, that the party, he said, we will, he didn't say who this we is, he said, we will build another masjid on the same land.
No,
do you remember
this
that?
This was also in the 1991 manifesto. In the 1991 manifesto,
what?
Also we have said, Congress Party manifesto.
Said what?
The Congress Party said that Congress Party stands for the construction of a temple, but without the demolition of the mosque.
Right.
But the whole narrative got changed because Mr. Advani and his entire cohort conspired to ensure the Rath Yatra resulted in the destruction of the mosque on the 6th of December 1992. So the whole narrative got changed.
So when the mosque was demolished, at the time Prime Minister Narasimha Rao said that we will build a masjid.
There is no point going back. The issue is the Supreme Court has bought a fine. The Supreme Court is supreme.
Right.
It may not be infallible all the time, but it is supreme. And once the Supreme Court has given, and that too, a 5-0 judgment.
Yes.
It's not even a 4-1 like the Aadhaar judgment, you know. It's a 5-0 unanimous judgment. I think we should move on, and we should move on keeping in mind that in 1991, it was the Congress government that passed the law in pursuance of its manifesto commitment that the protection of worship, the places of worship, Special Prohibition Act of 91 was passed, which was applicable to all other disputed sites other than Ayodhya.
Mm-hmm.
Because Ayodhya was special.
That's right.
So we delinked Ayodhya and we said that we will pass this law. And the Supreme Court, by the way, has made quite a substantial reference to this law and say that our judgment should be seen in light of the commitment to ensure that this law is implemented in letter and spirit. And that's what the Congress Party continues to believe.
So you respect the Supreme Court judgment, but do you still think that there should be that
we respect
a temple should
we,
be built we, and a masjid
we,
should be
we
built?
We respect the Supreme Court judgment. Whatever the Supreme Court has said, I'm sure will get implemented. But as far as I'm concerned, one aspect of the Supreme Court judgment which is central to moving forward is the respect for the Places of Worship Special Provisions Act 91 in letter and spirit, which has been underlined and emphasized by the Supreme Court as well.
So what about the Congress Party's take on building a masjid? Do you still think that another masjid, another mosque should be built?
I think these are issues that will be dealt with as a consequence of the Supreme Court judgment. The Supreme Court has made extensive references. They've said 5 acres of land should be given. How this will work out, I think we should move on. This controversy, this issue was created. It was created by Mr. K.K. Nair in 1949, who subsequently went on to become a Jansang MP.
Right.
And it got further, you know, momentum through this so-called Ayodhya movement, which only ended up polarizing and dividing our society. So now we have finality. Let's move on.
So last couple of questions, Jairam. The first is on the economy. You've been very critical, like we've discussed. What are your solutions? What suggestions would you have?
Why should I? I'm not in power. It's for the omniscient, omnipotent, omnipresent one up with the solutions.
No, that's okay. You've had your say on the Supreme Leader.
Why should we come up with solutions?
Because you are in the opposition and you have the country.
Nobody listens to us. When we said that demonetization is going to wreak havoc on the economy, we were poo-pooed and we were proved right. When we said on GST, when Dr. Manmohan Singh got up and said,
you have the country's interests at hand, that's why you're in the opposition.
When Parliament meets, within Parliament, when there is a debate, if and when the government has a debate on the current economic situation, we will certainly give suggestions. But the main suggestion I want to give is that you cannot fix the economy if you think you have all the answers. You cannot fix the economy if you think that what you're doing is the right thing.
So what do you want them to talk to you?
And you cannot fix the economy if you're sitting on a high pedestal and say that whatever I'm doing is right, whatever has happened before me is wrong.
So
and
I am
the only
them?
One who knows the answer.
Do you want them to talk to you? What do you
They have not talked to us. In fact, forget the economy.
They spoke to
us. He has not talked to anybody.
Former Prime Minister Dr. Manmohan Singh soon after.
There's been. Look at the number of all party meetings called when Dr. Manmohan Singh was Prime Minister on political, social, cultural administrative and economic issues, and you look at the number of all-party meetings this Prime Minister has called. There is no outreach.
There have been a few.
No, hardly any. I can't even think of one.
But has he talked to you, to the Congress, on the economy? Has there been any discussion
never,
on that?
Never. There's been only one meeting, if I remember right, 3 years ago, which Dr. Manmohan Singh and Mrs. Gandhi attended, which was on GST, which I, Dr. Manmohan Singh and Mrs. Gandhi reiterated our position on the GST, which was there in the select committee. None of our recommendations were listened to.
Do you think that if the Prime Minister calls a meeting today or calls upon
let him take the first step. Let him take the first step. Let him take the first step.
And you're willing to take
let him take the first step. Let
two?
Him take the first. Let him stop this vendetta against the former finance minister, who can give him suggestions on how to fix the economy.
Mr. Chidambaram, whose bill has been rejected.
This is nothing but political vendetta. It's political vendetta to the power of three, power of four.
But you've seen very little protest from the Congress on Mr. Chidambaram's
no,
issue.
Baby,
you haven't, you're not out in the streets. There isn't that much.
No, there
you've
is
made
some,
a lot of statements.
That's not true. Dr. Manmohan Singh has gone and visited him. Mrs. Gandhi has gone and visited him. So the others who have gone and visited him. It's not true that the Congress party is deeply concerned about this. This is sheer political vendetta. There's
Why
nothing
do you
else.
Say that?
Look at the manner in which Mr. Chidambaram is being treated. Look at the manner in which there is no case that has been made out against him. It is after 58 days or 59 days that a charge sheet, is filed. And people are saying he's a kingpin. Kingpin of what? What is the kingpin here? What is, I don't understand the language
so
that is being used.
What is the vendetta in these about? Why do you think there is a vendetta?
He's a finance minister who is critical of the government. He has been sharply critical of the government to silence him. They want
and
to
his
silence.
Word carries credibility.
Yes, he was, and he's a former finance minister, former home minister. Silence everybody in the opposition. Look at what they tried to do with Mr. Pawar. Set the ED on Mr. Pawar. So, anybody, whether it's in the corporate sector, whether it's in the media,
so last two
or
questions.
Whether it's in politics, feels the brunt of the official machinery.
So last two questions on the Citizenship Amendment Bill, which is going to come up in this session of Parliament.
The Citizenship Amendment Bill, the way, I don't know whether they're going to bring forward amendments to the Citizenship Amendment Bill, but the version of the Citizenship Amendment Bill that was passed by the Lok Sabha earlier, which got stuck in the Rajya Sabha, it violates Article 14, Article 21 of the Constitution. It is anti-secular, it's anti-constitutional. And in the context of the Northeast, it is completely contrary and contradictory to the NRC process.
So what do you do?
We cannot support the Citizenship Amendment Bill.
But what is the opposition? Do you protest against it? How do you?
It's
you don't
a bill.
The numbers anymore.
It's a bill. It's
you
a bill.
Have the numbers.
Yeah. So it's a bill. So we raise our issue. We raise our voice. We appeal to like-minded parties. We hope for a coalition of parties who will see the point that you cannot. On the one hand, on November 26th, you're going to be celebrating the 70th anniversary of the adoption of the Constitution. And at the same time, you're undermining and undercutting one of the essential pillars of the Constitution, which is that citizenship is not based on religion. This is what religious discrimination is being introduced into the Constitution through the Citizenship Amendment Bill. At the same time, you're paying obeisance to Dr. Ambedkar. This is complete hypocrisy.
Now, a sitting MP, Farooq Abdullah, is under house arrest in Srinagar, in his own house, of course, but this has been about 4 months since the 5th of August. What do you do about that when you have a new session, when you have the winter session of Parliament?
This is the continued situation in Jammu and Kashmir. I have not been there. I can only go by what Mr. Ghulam Nabi Azad has told me and what Sitaram Yechuri has told me, but more Mr. Azad because he has spent much more time. And from friends, the other day, former finance minister of JNK, who's an old friend of mine, who negotiated the agenda of alliance with Ram Madhav.
You're talking about Naseeb Drabu.
Naseeb Drabu, okay. Who negotiated this alliance with Ram Madhav 3 years ago. The first point of which said that we will not abrogate Article 370. The second thing which said we will not amend 35A.
Right.
And within 3 years, that was thrown out of the window. and everything opposite of what the agenda promised. And so he came to see
me. So do you have any ideas on how to deal with Jammu and Kashmir?
Well, I think, you know, we are in a very tight corner. We are in a difficult situation, and I think the government is reaping what it has sown. They have not consulted us. They have not talked to us. The manner in which everybody has seen, the world has seen, the way Mr. Amit Shah walked into the house at a few minutes past 12 and literally held a gun to everybody's head and said, this bill has to be passed today. And hardly any time was given for amendments. So I think it's in a very, very difficult situation we are in. And I really don't know what the game plan is as far as the government is concerned. And this completely bogus and fraudulent delegation of members of parliament of the European Union
right.
who are taken to give a clean chit to the international community, when your own members of parliament are not able to go, when your own opposition leaders are not able to go, I think it's really it's blatant double standards.
Mr. Jairam Ramesh, on this very bleak note, thank you for speaking to
thank
the print.
You.
This is Jyoti Malhotra for The Print. Please continue to watch our YouTube channel. It's live and buzzing.